Hello ladies and gentlemen, Yun here again with another episode of Live Build, and I do apologize, I was supposed to actually get this started an hour ago, but I put in the wrong time, so it's my fault. Today we're actually going to get into the fun stuff. We're going to complete the Nardeen model, and we're going to learn how to pose her and finally get her to a finished product. So we're also going to do some compositing, not the same compositing as you would when you're doing, for example, render layers or render passes, but we're going to use a much more faster way of doing this. So let's see how much we can get through, and I just need to show you guys what the model looks like, and I'll demonstrate the rigs and textures for you right now. So let's just take a look at this character. Right now, I have not actually added any, say, for example, cloth simulation, but we can see that the character is kind of pretty much ready to go. So her arms are done, and we've done all this during the rigging stages. So that's a shoulder. We've got a neck, and of course her facial expressions are pretty much ready to go. Okay, so I can play around with the facial expressions. Now for the facial rig, there's going to be a little bit more tweaking, because when you're doing something like facial rigging, you sort of have to do some test poses, and that's what we're actually doing now, because sometimes you can't actually see the mistakes until you do those test poses. So let's go ahead and see what we've got here. So I'm pretty happy with how the rig goes. I actually had to fix up the rig a few times, but let's go ahead and get started over here. And by the way, welcome to the stream for those, especially the one who was listening to his horror music or horror game. Enjoy the horror game while you're at it. Let's go ahead and begin. I just need to show you guys a complete product for now. And again, this is not necessarily the final, but more of a test so that we can see what it looks like. So this is the Nardeen character. You can see I've taken her to the to a finished product. This was using a rig that I had found a number of mistakes on, so I actually addressed that before this particular episode, because I didn't want to show you guys a broken rig, so I had to fix up those areas. But while I was at it, I decided to just take it to a finished product, just so that I can show you guys the end result that we're looking for. Okay, so in many ways I'm going to follow the same technique here, but other than that, it's just going to be fairly simple. We're just going to use Marmoset Toolbag to render her, and then we'll bring that image into something like After Effects, for example, do a little basic compositing, create the backgrounds and everything, and then we'll take her to the finished product. Okay, so let's go ahead and begin. I'm just going to move this to one side. Now, the one thing I do need to stress is that if you're going to pose your character, you have to learn some basics in for example, life drawing. Now, life drawing is one of those skill sets that basically teach you a lot of things. It teaches you how to sculpt a character in 3D, it teaches you how to model, teaches you how to pose, animate, and a lot of artsy skills. So if you're wanting to improve in your art in general, then doing some life drawing is the best way to go. Okay, so typically you will find some references, typically in the nude, and then you just give yourself 5 minutes to sketch that out very roughly on that person. Okay, and like you'll probably get to maybe like draw or iteration 400, number 400, and then you'll find that your skill set has improved a lot. So that's one thing that you should probably learn. Let's just go ahead and begin posing. By the way, your Watcher series is very helpful. No problem. Hope you are enjoying the Russia series. And by the way, Russia series, guys, I have actually created the Russia series, for those who don't know. That's actually inside my channel. You can go ahead and take a look at that right now. Basically, it's an entire course teaching you how to create a character from start to finish. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and show you guys this character here again. So we're pretty much there. The only thing I do need to fix is the clothing. So we don't actually have any cloth simulation right now. So if I were to play it, there's no cloth simulation. So let me go ahead and save an iteration of this project file. And I'm going to save it under 12, number cloth. I'll just put cloth as the postfix, so cloth. Because I don't want to add the cloth yet. Again, this character is not 100% complete. There's going to be more coming a little bit later. So let's go ahead and add some cloth. So the first thing to do when we're doing cloth is really, really simple. We're just going to use Ncloth, Maya's Ncloth. Now, just remember, I am using an older version of Maya, so this is 2012, but it does the job. I'm just going to select the mesh and create or make meshes collide with end cloth. Okay, so just click that. So now that is officially an end cloth. Okay, I'm going to do the same. Oh, sorry, I clicked the wrong one. So we're going to give selected mesh and create an end cloth. There we go. Okay, so if I were to press play, it should theoretically work. I think I stuffed that up. Probably stuffed it up, but that's okay. Here we go. Just going to undo, and then I'm going to create the cloth again. All right, now that should work. Hopefully. I'm just going back to my settings, just check to make sure it's working. I don't think it's broken or anything. Pretty sure it's fine. All right, so just go grab B98. There we go, much better. Just couldn't see it. Pardon me. Excuse me. So all we have to do is go to end cloth again, to the second one, which is the bottom skirt, and now we have end cloth for both of them. And reason being is because I want to get my character to sort of twist around like she's dancing or something, and then let the cloth sort of emulate that simulation so that we can get a good read on the inertia of where she's spinning. So that's another thing that we can do. Plus, it also makes it look a lot better. So that's basically it. All right. So now that we've got a cloth shape, we actually need to add some collision. So very, very important. So when we add collision, I'm just going to select these two, and then create a collider, and select the cloth, select these two cloth underneath, and then create a collider for the feet here. Okay. So once we've created that, just play, just double check to make sure it actually doesn't clip. So you can see the cloth is now actually colliding with itself and the mesh mesh underneath, so which is really, really good. So now what I want to do is I need to plant it there so that it doesn't fall down, okay, because it doesn't make any sense. So what we need to do is actually create some vertex paint weights. So what we do is we just go to end mesh, let's go down to paint vertex properties, and the only thing we're really interested in is something called input mesh attract, which is over here, also called input attract. So once again, that's end mesh, paint vertex properties, and input attract. I'm just going to click the options box right here, and once you put it as white, basically you're saying to the computer, okay, the input mesh attract, which, by the way, you can find it in your attributes editor. So just select the mesh, go to attributes editor. You got a bunch of settings here like collision, but I'm interested in the dynamics properties. And down here you have input mesh attract, okay? So if I were to play this, you can see it still falls down. But because it's actually skinned to the bones, I want the bones to actually control some of the mesh, okay, as per normal. So I don't want some of this cloth to simulate. So what I want to do is turn input mesh attract to 1. Now if I were to play, and you can see, if I play, you can see the cloth is now attached to the bone, so to speak. But when I go ahead and paint some areas out, so for example, I'll just paint the bottom part black. And this is where we just be really careful. And this is really fast, by the way. I know I'm sort of rushing, but really, I'm not too worried about all those little tiny tweaks at this stage, because I can do that a little bit later. Just by way of demonstration, we're going to show you guys how to get this to the finish line as fast as we can. So now if I painted the vertex paint or the vertex maps, we can go ahead and play. You can see that the cloth is simulating down below but not above, meaning I can actually move or animate the top of the mesh, and then it will affect the rest of the character, okay, or part of that cloth there. Let's do the same thing for the one below, and we'll get to the simulation just in a minute. So once again, I'm going to go to input mesh attract. Everything else is white, so really I only need to paint certain areas white. I just want to make sure my input mesh attract is put as 1 on the bottom. And I'm just going to paint the top. This is basically where it's going to hold the cloth in place, okay? You can use other methods. For example, you can use like bone vertex nucleuses or constraints, vertex constraints, but I find that there's not a lot of control. There is a place for them, but in this particular case, we're not that interested in it. Okay, so now you can see the cloth is simulating down below, but not above. Now, you can tell that the cloth, as I'm playing, it's not looking like cloth. It's very, well, wide. So that's primarily because of the nucleus. So if we go to our outliner, I'm going to go to nucleus very quickly. And let's just go ahead and turn the scale attributes. I'm just going to change the space scale to 0.01. Okay. Whoops, pardon me. That's a little bit too much. So let's go back to my nucleus. I'm just going to put a 0.1. Let's go ahead and play this, and you can see it's much better. So this now behaves a lot more like cloth, okay? If we go to our nucleus, we can play around with other settings. For example, wind speed. You can add wind, so if I put wind at 200, you can see we can add some wind inside as well, okay? So quite simple in terms of general workflow for cloth. Again, there's a lot more you need to do, like get, I don't know, all kinds of things, right? So I'm just going to change the space scale to 0.20 just to see what we get, because I see some of our cloth is clipping into each other. It's not much, doesn't worry me too much at this stage, because we're just trying to get a, you know, relatively decent result. Okay, so that's good. I'm happy with that. Everything else is ready. The character is ready to go. Cloth is ready to go. So we're going to begin posing out this character. Now, there are a number of things we can do. Once again, if we use this as a basic reference, you can see that I got her to sort of do a very basic dance move, but it's not, in terms of posing, this is not fully exaggerated, okay? It's not complete because there were some limitations and mistakes with the rig, as I mentioned before. So because I've actually fixed them, we can get a much tighter or much more exaggerated pose, and that's what we want for a cartoon character. So let's go ahead and begin here. And remember, when you're posing your character, you also need to get a relatively decent idea as to how you want the character to act. Like, sorry, what your character is sort of like. So I'm just going to draw it out here, because drawing is much quicker than posing it out in your thing, your computer. I was just going to say that. And I'm also going to look for some dancing references here. Okay. So once again, life drawing, very, very good, because when you're doing life drawing, you're essentially creating a mental library for yourself. Okay, so life drawing is very useful when you need to learn how to do animation. So what am I using for rendering? Yeah, that's kind of true. Cloth Dynamics, it can be a little bit tricky to control, but I'll show you that in just a second. What we want to do is just get the pose right first. Now, for the Nardeen character, ballet was a very was a nice reference that I was going to use. Like, that's how I envisioned this particular character, but obviously that's not ballet. And just remember, they do this character, you want the body language to tell the story for the audience, okay? So if you're going to create a selling image, people need to see this character in one, like, half a second and know exactly what the character's like, her characteristics, her personality and such. Dancing is one way to sort of show what she's kind of like, but in my case, I want to also get the timeline, the era as well, which is the Renaissance era, and that's going to be a little bit different than the contemporary ballet that we see right here. So you want something a little bit less, I don't know, like that, but a little bit more exotic somewhat. So let's go ahead and try that. But what I want to do is just take some mental screenshots on ballet, primarily on spinning. So let's go spin. So ballet spin, something like that. So we've got one image here, which is really good. That kind of catches your eye, okay? Other images look like, I'm not sure, something like that, maybe. We also have, well, there's a bunch of other places you can do. So this one's actually quite nice as well. But I kind of want her hands to be up in the air, okay? So again, what's very useful about life drawing is that you actually can pose it in your brain and get it out on paper. Oh no, my Wacom tablet's a bit out of whack. I just need to fix this, because I do have two screens. There we go, much better. Okay, it's bugged. This is not good. Okay, never mind. We're just going to pose her out. And this is, again, very risky. I don't recommend this, so I'm kind of going against my rule, but that's fine. Let's go to this character right here, and again, we have the cloth ready to go. I'm actually going to save it as another iteration, because I actually completed the cloth. So once we've completed the cloth, I'm going to go to class number 2. Alright, so how do you pose a character? Well, it's quite simple, really. Again, as an animator, you don't really need a lot of technical know-how. All you have to do is just know how a rig works, okay? Because rigs generally work the same no matter where you go, whether you're working in a AAA studio or if you're working for yourself or a video games company. Rigs, particularly bipedal rigs like this, they all work the same. And they usually have the same features, like inverse IK handles and all this other stuff. So I'm just going to show you guys how to start posing. First things first, I've already got the character planted on the ground, her feet, okay, so I can actually move this around and her feet will remain planted to the ground, okay, which is good because that's generally how you get started with character posing. But we usually begin with the hips, okay, so we start with the hips and then we go outwards. So I've got a pose in mind. I'm probably just going to try and duplicate this particular pose and get a much nicer pose, okay, just to help you guys out so that you don't get too confused. So what I want to do is start with some keyframes, and because we have cloth here, okay, I kind of want the cloth to settle properly. So getting your first pose, like, you know, in frame number 1 can be a little bit tricky for a stills image, okay? There's also other things with cloth that I'm not going to go through. For example, getting the cloth to settle and then saving the cloth pose, for example, but I'm not going to do that. We're just going to do it the simple way. So let's just start with this. I'm going to create a frame here. I'm just going to make this frame, let's say frame 30. Okay, and so 1 is the resting pose, 30 is going to be the final pose, which is going to be somewhat like this. Alright, let's begin. And how we do this is quite simple. I'm just going to start twisting the character somewhat. And don't worry about the cloth, I know the cloth is a bit odd, but because it's animating, the cloth will settle, and that's kind of what we want. So let me go back to my end pose here. And what I want to do is just get her to... we'll start with a rough pose with the arms. So I've twisted her body. That's kind of what we want. And what I'm doing here, I'm going to change it to local, is just roughly move her body to the pose that I want. Okay, so we're not trying to get perfect poses. We're just trying to get a good read on the general body language. Now, again, the twisting part of her body is going to be somewhat like this. So we're just going to do that. Another thing is we can go ahead and tilt her head. One other thing, guys, there is an issue with the eyes that if you were to go, for example, like sideways, the eyes sort of dope out a little bit. Okay, that's actually a limitation inside Maya. I haven't actually fixed that, so it requires a bit of fixing. I'm not going to go through that, but what I'm going to do is actually just take the eyes off its own aim axes, okay, because I want to move them individually, so I might just undo that just until I get the body straight like this. And from here, I'm going to remove the aim constraint because that's actually causing us some issues. And hopefully, I'm just trying to find where the constraint has gone. I believe it's kind of messed up. Oh, sorry, it's not that, it's the skin. So I'm going to remove the skin cluster. Okay, so now I can move them individually. So I want to also center the pivot. Okay, so that's much better, gives us a lot more control. Because again, we're just posing her, I'm not too worried about getting or the rig properly right. It's all about the end result at this stage. Okay, let's continue. And of course the eyes are coming out, so I need to just parent that to the top of the bones again. Sorry guys. Okay, so we've got the eyes here. And now we can continue posing. So again, what I'm doing is I just want to get the pose right. And I forgot to create the keyframe, so I'm just creating keyframe now. Ah, that's frustrating. I'm just going to skin this on so I don't have any issues. So let's just go ahead and smooth bind. Make sure the weights are there. So, yep, which is perfect. And then I can remove it a little bit later. Alright, let's go and finish posing our character. And posing doesn't take too long because we are just getting basic feel of her character pose. And you can also use the UI as well just to get a good result. So I'm just going to tilt her head. I might even work on her expression as well. So let's go ahead and do that. Just remove the bone so that we can see it. And I might go ahead and just see if we can close her eyes slightly. I'm not sure how that's going to work. You can see it's looking a bit odd, and that's because the eye rig is going to have to change something, but that's fine. So maybe lose her eyelids here. She looks a little bit disinterested, but we're just going to change the expression so we get something a little bit nicer. So just maybe lift the eyebrows up. Maybe add a small smile. It looks a bit creepy. So we'll just move this up. There we go. That's a little bit nicer. Just remember, like, generally the teeth are not visible. So the bottom teeth, my apologies. So that's what we're doing. We're just going to fix that. And it is a limitation in the rig itself. And of course our eyes are a little bit off, but I can fix that a bit later, so let's just leave it as it is. And I'm just using the UI right now just to get a rough pose of the smile there, so. Okay, we're not sure about that expression, so let's continue and see what we get. Now for the hands, I'm going to get her to move down that direction, so we'll go ahead and do that. And of course we've got the hips. Now over time, as you get better at this, you'll be able to get the poses really fast because once again, you've done a lot of life drawing and now your brain is filled with all these mental examples on how your character is going to be posed. So that's very useful. It's a very, very useful skill. I would say it's probably one of the main fundamentals. So let's just go ahead and get that. Okay, head's tilted too low. So what we're going to do, just going to move her head down like this somewhat, just by way of example. I'm not too worried about that. And of course I want her back to sort of move in that direction. Okay, looking good. Alright, let's see what else we've got here. So now you can see the cloth is going to settle. But we're going to work on the feet now, so let's go ahead and do the feet. And again, the feet, we already have IK handles, so I'm going to create an IK handle right here. And just lift it up slightly, lift her leg up. I'm also going to hide the blouse or the skirt. So let's just hide that so that we can see where the feet is going. And the reason why I'm animating the feet is that I need to know how it's going to affect the cloth. So very, very important that we get that right. Otherwise, we run into all sorts of weird issues. Especially like when it comes to clipping and such. And of course we've got some more issues on the back over here, so I'm just going to go ahead and fix this up. Okay, so the feet's looking good. So just lifting the feet up like this. And I'm going to go back to some of my dancing references. So let's go ahead, dancing. So there's all styles of dancing. I'm more interested in the Renaissance. And this one's a very good image where you can see her hands are sort of like in a weird position. It's more finger posing. So we're just looking through some of these references, and we're taking mental screenshots. Nothing too fancy, just looking at and seeing where something will be really nice. This is another one, so I kind of like that cloth twist, but that's more of a cloth simulation aspect or issue. Normally I'd be painting this out in Photoshop to get a good result, but unfortunately I haven't. And this is one reason why you need to, so that it just helps get good results really, really fast. Okay, I think I've got a decent idea, so let's just continue here. I've got an issue with that binding there, but the pants, you're not going to actually see it, so I'm not worried about it. Okay, so that's looking good. So you can see the cloth is there. It's kind of settling. So we're getting some nice cloth movement right there. Another thing I want to do is also just change the heel here, because I do want her to stand on her tippy toes somewhat. Okay, and then we can just repose her feet. And this is one thing that's good about the IK handles. You don't have to worry too much about any weirdness, generally speaking, which is good. So I'm going to just move her center of gravity. She is a little off balance, which is not good. And we're going to get her feet here. Let's just go ahead and move her feet down. I might even move her feet a little bit higher as well. So we'll just go ahead and pose that over there once more. And let's just see what we get. Of course, we've got a resting point issue, so. Actually, need to move that down to the resting point. Okay, that's looking good. Once again, just move the hips so that we get a good result. You want to make sure she's actually in balance, otherwise it just looks weird, looks strange. Okay, and now we're going to go to this one. Her expression's a bit creepy, so I'm going to fix this one. And whenever you're posing your character, you do want to make sure that they're definitely in balance. If they're not balanced, it just looks weird to the audience, so center of gravity is very, very important. And over here, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do a little small rotate of the hands like this. And let's go back to the arms, the top of the arms, like so. And I think we're getting close to that pose, which is good. Another thing I can do is actually add a item or a prop that will sort of signify it. Maybe a tambourine, which is something that I was like very quickly getting ready. So hopefully we can get some good results. All right, so with the hands, I'm going to pose the hands just very quickly, because if they're flat like that, it's just kind of odd. So what we do is, it's kind of a simple task. I'm just going to use the UI and then I will stagger the fingers or the finger poses until we get a kind of good result. So that's sort of what I want. So I stagger the fingers. And of course the thumb. And the thumb's quite simple. Nothing too fancy. Okay, so that's sort of the twist that we're looking for. We're just looking for that twist. So we're going to move her hand here. Now remember, the proportions of this character are a little bit more chibi-ish, which is the cartoon style that I'm going for. So there are some poses that are limited. But the good thing about cartoon characters is that you can get really, really good exaggeration. And that's the advantages, that's one of the main advantages of cartoon style. I'm just going to move the chat over here. Alright, fantastic. Looking good. And so we're going to move over here, and another thing about rendering, which we will get to, is that in Unreal Engine, well, any renderer that you use, for example, if you're going to use V-Ray, Mental Ray, Unreal Engine, or just plain, just normal, I guess, normal rendering methods, it's going to look slightly different, okay? So you need to take that into account because the shaders are different for each rendering technique. So it depends on what style you want to go for. I've got some issues with the neck over here, so I'm afraid it's something that I do have to fix at some point, which I need to actually right now. So just had a bit of an issue with the neck, and just trying to find where the problem is coming from, because we have some stray weights. And this is one of the common things when it comes to rigging, is that you're going to see some vertices go out of place. And that might be your mistake, that might be the mistake of the rigger or the skinner. Okay, cool. So it's actually the spine. I just need to very quickly erase that, guys. So let me go ahead and do that, because we don't want this bleeding into our work at all, otherwise it's just going to look weird. So good thing is I can actually go back to the resting pose, and just click these, or remove the weights basically. So these are some of the issues you sort of catch while you're posing your character. I didn't see it in the previous one before because I didn't actually have any problems here, but the it might have happened when I was weighting my character and suddenly the weights are all just start bleeding into each other when I was adjusting something, so it's kind of my fault. And that's okay, because you will find situations where you'll get yourself into these, or you'll find these problems. Okay, that's a very quick fix, so that's okay, so I'm not too worried about that. So far the twist is looking quite nice. Let's just play this and then twist the character. And that's looking good. So the cloth is reading well, there's no clipping. Tail is quite nice as well. And let's just go ahead and start putting this into Marmoset. Now, I want to explain very quickly what Marmoset is. Marmoset is a physical-based renderer. Okay, it's just used for previews or basic rendering. And it works in a similar way as you would see in like video games and such. Okay, so Unreal Engine 4 is another, is one example. But basically what you do is you bring your model in, and then you apply your textures on there, and then you can get a really good end result, okay, in terms of rendering. Like we're talking subsurface scattering, metal materials, and all that other stuff. And that's exactly what I used in the previous the example that I was doing over here. Okay, so Marmoset was used to render this. Obviously the backgrounds and everything we're going to create, so that's what we're going to do. So I'm going to use Marmoset. That's a tambourine, by the way, and initially I was going to use it for her, but I think the texturing, we'll see how much time we'll get through, get at the end of this. But the important thing is to make sure we get a good pose for this character, so. Okay, once again I'm going to change the direction of her neck. And of course I want to move the direction of her eyes as well. Okay, so, well, I might just leave that there for now. Let's just work on her facial pose. So we're going to move the UI over here. That's horrible, I'm rotating it around, but I don't really care at this stage. So it's fine. Okay, and so we're going to give her sort of a bigger grin. The other thing is, I can actually use normal controls to get a good pose. Let's just go ahead and do that. I'm going to click the red keys to just adjust her facial pose. And remember, I don't really care about like constantly using the UI. This is kind of what it's for. We're just using whatever tools we have at hand to get a good end result. And of course, I'm trying to hide the bottom teeth as best as I can. That's not like, we're not trying to hide the teeth completely, but generally when you have their mouth, you sort of want their mouth to be a little bit readable-ish as a grin or a smile. So that's what we're doing. We're just aiming for that cartoon feel. So that's kind of the aim here. So we need a bit of folding in the top because that's where the muscles are, okay? So this is looking good. Oh, that's actually the nose. That's part of the rig that I did not add. Okay, so I'm giving the lips a nice arc. And also, I do want to just adjust the mouth or the jawline, because it is a little bit too high. And I might lower the lips as well. Not too much. Otherwise, it looks like she's just sneering. So we want to be careful about that. So there's a lot of little things that will make or break the pose of your character's facial expression. Okay, so that's looking really nice. So I just want to see what I can do with the eyes here. So what I'm doing is just maybe give her a wink, I think. Which is kind of nice. Because remember, well, the character is quite a cutish kind of a character, so we just sort of want to apply that. And to give her a softer expression, we're going to lower the edges of the eyebrows. And I'm just going to adjust the eyebrows until we get something that's good, okay? Hello there, welcome to the channel. So we're just about to... ready to start tightening up a pose, but I'm trying to get the expression right as best as I can, because right now the expression is one of the main things that's going to sell the character. So as we all know, when you're doing facial expressions, whenever you look at a person's face, it's their eyes that you notice first. So I want to make sure she has a cutish kind of an expression. Now normally you would see in other cartoons or movies that they have like a disjointed sort of expression like that, okay? I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to keep it really, really simple. Just make sure she's sort of have a nice, happy dancing pose. Okay, so I'm just going to move the cheeks forward a little bit because her smile's a little bit too intense. And just remember, this character is described to be a very humble character with a bit of a fiery temper. But I do want her to have that gentleness come through. So that's going to come through her mouth as well. Okay. Let's go ahead and just move this down because it's not exactly working. It's not working for me, so... And over time, you'll get better with expressions, like facial expressions. But really, facial expressions is nothing new. It's all about just getting like the good end result, okay, as best as you can. I'm actually going to lose the eye on that side, so let's just go ahead and pose this one. And maybe give her the wink on her left one, because that looks a little bit better. Something like that. Okay, so I just want to see if I can, how hard I can push that wink. And just remember, when you're winking, you do sort of lift your cheeks up a little bit. And that's actually my fault. I didn't add a rigging segment for the cheek here. So, and you also need to lower the brow, okay? Now, in terms of the brow with that little wink, I might want to make it a little bit softer. So we don't want the wink to be too intense. I just want it to be like giving a glancing wink to, say, for example, another character. Let's just test and see her eyes on the right. I want her to have a softer expression. So something like that. It's looking good. Okay, I'm happy with the expression. Let's leave that for now. I'm just going to turn off those controls so that we can see our character's expression better. Okay. Again, it's more of a cute kind of a pose for a scene, perhaps. We're not sure, so we'll see how we go. Okay. All right, let's continue on the body. This time we're going to start tightening up the body in terms of how her balance. Now, her balance is still off, completely off, so I do need to sort of do that. Okay, and I'm just going to simulate it. Oops. Here we go. Much better. Sorry. Just going to simulate it so that she's sort of a little bit more forward. And that's a much nicer pose, okay? Again, it's the balance. The center of gravity is very important. If it's off balance, unless there's some kind of inertia happening, like physics, general physics, you want to keep the character centered as best as you can, okay? So I actually like that pose, it's quite nice. Another thing is I do want her to sort of move in this direction because again the center of balance is off. So she is dancing and I don't know the exact story but I'm kind of just going for it. Okay, so we've got that very small twist which is looking good. Now for her legs, for her right leg, I do want her right leg to sort of come up a little bit because remember, you also want to just check the silhouette of your character, okay? If you can't read the silhouette correctly, the pose is not going to be as great as it is. So we want to make sure the silhouette is really, really nice. So I'm going to go ahead and just move her leg up a little bit more. So something like that. Just so that we can see the skirt sort of coming up and then we see more of the skirt, okay? As best as we can. Okay, so that's good. Let's go ahead and simulate this again. And I love that. Really, really like it. I like how the skirt's coming up. You can see her second foot here. And she's giving that wink to another character. And I don't actually want her to break the fourth wall too much. I actually do want her to just stay in character. Okay, so that means you don't want the character to be looking at the screen, unless of course that's what you want. It's up to personal taste, but in my case, I want her to stay in character. This is just a demonstration of what we are trying to achieve, okay? Now for the arms, I'm going to tighten up the arms a little bit, so let's go ahead and do that. And once again, you also need to take into account which direction the camera is going to be facing. In my case, it's going to be somewhat like this, so I do want to see more of an arm like that. So this is kind of like a dance routine. So you want to get the hands right as best as you can and hopefully we'll get a nice end result. So let's just see what we've got here. So that's looking good. There's another thing is that the twist, I want to add an additional twist. I'm just going to add maybe another 10 frames, so 40 frames. And what this is going to be is I'm not going to animate the bones, I'm just going to animate the reference, okay? So the reference basically moves the whole character, whoops, the control reference I should say. So it moves the whole character like so. And what I'm going to do is animate or create a keyframe at 30 and 40. And as a final pose, I'm just going to spin her around maybe 180 degrees, something like that. And let the cloth sort of follow as a final part, okay? So the first 30 frames, the cloth settles, and then the last 10 frames, it will sort of spin around relatively quickly to get a good cloth simulation. So that's a bit extreme, so we're going to have to adjust it, but now you can see that the cloth has that inertia. It pushes forward, it just makes the character come to life, okay? Now, in animation, you don't do this. If you're creating an animated sequence, or a scene that you don't actually do that because it's just going to mess it all up. But in my case, this is just for a still image, okay? That's it. So her hands, I want to just go back to frame number 30 once again. So at frame number 30, we're just looking at her pose and just seeing if that kind of works, which it sort of does. I'm going to go back to my control reference. Let me remove those keyframes so you can't see that, but I'm just deleting the keyframes in my graph editor. And then I'm going to move this down to the pivot point. Will be at the center of the character here, which is quite important. That's really, really important for me. So now I can create the keyframe to 40 and then maybe twist her a little bit less, something like that. And that's looking much nicer, actually. I'm really happy with that cloth. Another problem is the cloth clipping, and this is a simulation issue. You need to take this into account because you are going to encounter this problem. Again, this comes to adjusting it while you're testing the character. So that's probably one reason why some people see like characters in movies, for example, just over white backgrounds. Usually that's like they're demonstrating the full extent of the character. It's a bit of a test animation, so to speak, but we don't actually have that right now. So what I need to do is just make sure I just take that into account, the clothing. If it's clipping through, then one thing I'm going to do is just adjust the thickness. So I might change this to 1, and hopefully that won't collide. Well, especially with fast movements, cloth can sometimes clip into each other, which makes it really, really bad. So that's kind of not what we want. Okay, in this case, it's looking good. I might also have to adjust the vertex painting, so we'll see how we go. We've got 15 minutes, and it's not bad for 1 hour's worth of work. So in 1 hour, we're able to pose, and the renderer part is going to be relatively easy. So I might extend this episode a little bit. So let's go back to my end mesh, and again, I want to get rid of just a little bit. Let's go ahead and smooth. So I'm just going to flood smooth that. And one reason why I'm flood smoothing is because of I just want the cloth to sort of bleed a little bit down. Okay, so smooth it once, smooth it twice, smooth it 3 times, and then I'm going to just replace the top part. Just remember the belt is actually covering this area here. And then we'll get a relatively good result. Hopefully not, it's not going to clip too much, so we'll see how we go. Alright, so that's looking good. Alright, let's just test it, because we don't want it to clip into that belt right there, as best as we can. Probably not going to be 100% possible, but the more we do that, it's kind of flipping out a little bit over there, so that's okay. Yep. Might also have to lower her legs. So as nice as that pose is, it's just a little bit too high, okay? Because when we're doing that, we're actually clipping into the rest of that. So I'm just trying to keep it technically speaking, correct, as best as we can. And it's okay, we're not going to get super excellent results all the time. Just as best as we can get it. And then the final spin right there, which is looking really nice. So the cloth is no longer clipping, which is good. That's what we want. Another thing I might also add is probably the collision to the belt. So maybe not so much, because there is some issue with that. But I can just adjust that a little bit later. So the most important thing is to make sure that we don't clip too much. I'm going to go back to my input mesh track and just add it to 2. And by the way, you can go higher than 1. This basically gives you a little bit more leeway when it comes to getting super, super good results. So again, just simulate that. And then so at frame 39, it's looking quite nice. And that's good. Alright, I might actually adjust the jaw. The jaw is a bit too high. There we go, that's a little bit better. Alright, so quite happy with how this is going. And we're just about ready to bring this into the Marmoset Toolbag. And don't worry about some of the textures are going to change when we get to that point. Okay, so I kind of like that twist. The twist is really nice. So at frame 37, I'm pretty happy with that. Now, in terms of posing, I'm just going to adjust something. So let's just go ahead and adjust a few things. Okay, so the feet down there, I just want it to look a little bit more exaggerated. There we go. So that's much nicer. We'll probably end up having the pose around here. The silhouette is reading quite nice. Maybe this leg bit is not that great, so I might just lift it up. And that's kind of good. Okay. I'm still thinking I want to add a tambourine. So what I'm going to do is, I'm not too sure yet. We'll see how we go. So let's just adjust the hand. Just adjust the hand slightly because I want that nice curve, that nice arc to a body, because that's the main selling point of this particular pose right here. The other thing is, when it comes to body language, you also want to know that when, so for example, she's just trying to get someone's attention, you just want to twist her body slightly in that direction. So that's what I'm doing. And you get these pose references from a variety of different sources. For example, like life experience is one method. Also going to adjust that as well. There's no cloth on that. I might actually leave it there. I'm pretty happy with that. I don't think I'll bother with the tambourine. Initially, I was going to add the tambourine in just by way of making it a little bit different, but I think this is going to be enough. So at frame 35, I'm quite happy with her general pose. Of course, you can tighten it up a little bit more if you want. That's up to you, but I'm just going to leave it there for now. Okay. So now what I want to do is just adjust the eye, because remember, I want her to be looking at a character, probably somewhere across the room, maybe. So let's go back here. So maybe across the room. Like that. And of course over here I do want to adjust just the clipping. And this is going to be just manual, so I'm taking the quick lazy route. Let's just go ahead and select some vertices and then we'll just soft select by pressing B. Like that. And just move it up a little bit, okay? So nothing too fancy. The tail, of course, is another thing. Might just save this as well, and once again, I'm going to be really naughty and just delete the skin cluster. Normally, you would not do this, of course, but I didn't actually add a rig on the tail, so that's my mistake. So for the tail, remember she's twisting in that direction, so you want her tail to sort of go in that direction as well. So maybe it'll be something like that. Nice characters like this can be a little tricky to get right. And again, we're keeping in mind the silhouette, so you still want to get as much of that pose as possible. Okay, it has to be readable for the audience. If you can read the silhouette, okay, if you can read the character like this, then you know the body language, it's really good. Okay, so that's what we're aiming for. Now in terms of the skirt down here, I might actually adjust it, but I'm not sure. I think I'll probably leave it for now. Other than that, I'm quite happy with how this the twist, the cloth is working, so we'll leave it like this. I'm going to spin around just to double check, make sure I'm not losing any or getting too much clipping. So, because remember, you are trying to keep it quite what I'm saying. I'm saying you want to keep it as tight as possible, okay? Especially if you want to do a turnaround for the character. It's quite important. Over here we've got some issues with the skirt, but we can fix that in a later at a later time. But other than that, the character is quite nice, so there's probably a little bit of clipping here. That's with the shoulders, but I don't think I'm going to be too worried about that. Let's just move the shoulder slightly so that we don't clip too much there, and maybe we'll move the arm instead. Yep. So that's looking nice. Quite nice. And I'm okay with some clipping as long as it's like quite neat, okay? So if it's clipping like that, that's okay. This is a game character, so we're not too worried about that. All right, that's pretty much it for this particular segment. Let's go ahead and finish up with the render. And it's going to be simple. We're just going to select the mesh, and I'm going to export the selection as an OBJ. It's just an object, so I'll call this Nardeen Dance Object. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Marmoset Toolbag to get this rendered out. We're also going to use After Effects to create the very basic backgrounds, and once we have that, we've got something that we can present to the rest of the world, so it's going to be quite easy. Let's just go ahead and go to Marmoset Toolbag, and what I'm going to do is go ahead and import the mesh. Just import mesh, and then we'll go to test pose. Oh, sorry, not test pose, we have Nardeen Dance, that thing. I'm also going to delete the tambourine because I don't think I need it, to be honest. Alright, so that's the mesh we have right here. Now, how we do this is quite simple. All we have to do is, we're going to start with the clothing. So with the default, I'm just going to go and load up the textures. So start with the clothing. I'm going to grab the clothing normal maps. Okay, so that's the clothing. Now, it's all over the other faces as well, so I'm not worried about that for now. Let's just continue on. I'm going to start with grab the gloss. And then I'll grab the albedo, also known as the diffuse or color layer. So now that's the clothing here. Another thing I also want to do is just change the background. So I'm not happy with that background. It's just a bit annoying. Let's just start with something like that. Okay. You can hold shift and then drag it around to get some interesting results. And what I'm going to do is go to my metal. Okay, so now you can see that the character, the map, the cloth is looking much more like cloth as well. Okay, so that's looking good, and we've just quickly loaded in sort of the rest of that stuff. All right, I'm going to go to cutout for the, transparency. So you got transparency down here, some holes. And also, I do want to make sure I have color back faces as off, okay? I don't want that to be on at all. Same with this particular one. And of course, the sleeves and collar. Okay, we want to be able to see the back faces of all those polygons, which is really good. Okay, so now the character's looking good. I'm just going to adjust the light, see what we get. So the cloth, I'm looking at the cloth right now, and I love it. It's looking fantastic. Really, really happy with how the simulation has turned out. That's probably by luck, but in any case, it's still good, so still pretty happy with that. All right, let's continue on and see what else, what other settings we can have. Another thing is when it comes to rendering, I also want to add, for example, high resolution shadows, ambient occlusion. You can play with the ambient occlusion strength if you want. I'm just going to keep it there for now. And I'm also going to create a light. So we're going to go to scene, new light, and just apply it here. We'll change the brightness, change the radius as well. You can also change the shape, so the softness of it. You can add cast shadows, so we can have shadows on our character. And this is one way we can render our character and make the character look really good. Okay, we just use something like Marmoset Toolbag to get a relatively good result. See how we go. You can also play the radius or contact refinement. Let's just apply the soft. Now the soft is actually, it actually plays around with the shape of the light. Okay, and what we're doing is we're making the light a little bit bigger, so that way you get some nice soft shadows. Now this lighting is very, very intense, so I'm not going to do too much over there. Okay, let's go back to our texture. So this is our default texture. I'm just going to find, here we go. So this is a specular map we've got for now, but that's basically it. So that's looking good overall anyway. All right, now I'm going to go to new. I'm going to create a skin. And we're going to start with just the face, okay? So I'm going to apply that skin. And as always, I'm going to leave the normal map out. We'll just go ahead and add the albedo, which has already been done. Okay, so that's the albedo. I'm just going to drag and drop it onto a variety of our objects here. Okay, so that's looking good. Next thing is the specularity map. We want to turn that off. Actually, no, we don't have anything, so we just turn the specularity down. And as you go down here, you can see you got a bunch of other settings like fuzz. I'm also going to turn Fresnel off, so this gives us a much softer looking skin. Let's play around with the subdermis or subdermal. We also have translucency. Just turn the sky translucency down. So translucency should be somewhere there. And I'm just going to give a bit of fuzz on his skin, okay? This is a cartoon character. I'm not worried about getting super excellent results, so. Okay, so subdermis, I'm going to change that. Just make it a little bit more orange. It's basically subdermal map. Okay, so this gives our character a little bit more, of that skin texture. I'm also going to change the lighting to orange, and of course you can play around with the settings, the lighting as well, especially if the lighting isn't looking too hot. Just very, very basic lighting like that. Okay, so that's looking good for the skin. I'm going to name this face. Let's duplicate this. I'm going to add it to the rest of that body over here. Got this hair, and same deal with the hair. I'm just going to add the hair texture. So there's no normal mapping because I don't think we actually need the normal maps in this particular case. Okay, so once again, just double checking the skin, make sure it's readable, make sure it's not too intense. All right, duplicate, and we're going to add the skin. So this will be the skin. Go to my albedo map like this. So now we have the skin for our body. Just drag and drop it in. It's pretty simple. Oops. Don't want to miss the toes, that's for sure. So that's the skin looking good. Alright, and of course, finally, we've got the eyeball. So I'm just going to add the eye. New material. I'm going to use the albedo map of our eyeball right there. Oh, sorry, one thing I forgot was the gloss of the eyes is actually going to be there, so just want to get rid of that. I'm also going to add a very basic specularity map. Okay, and of course when it comes to gloss, just make sure the gloss is not too intense. So this is a nice basic render of our character. I'm going to apply a secondary light. So the primary light will have, or also known as the key light, will give it the most amount of light like this. But then the secondary light, we sort of want it to fill the back of our character like that. Okay, so we have that dark spot. And one thing I forgot was to add the skin on the bottom of that tail right there as well. So now we have a nice, relatively good looking character. Just going to change the perspective slightly because we do want a little bit of perspective. And that's kind of a good angle for me to go with. Okay. It's like your preference is going to be different. Let's just play around with the lighting and see what we can do, maybe we can add the lighting, the key lighting to her side over here, and then I'll put the back lighting over here. And when it comes to backlighting, what we're trying to do is get some good rim shaders. So something like that, you can see the rim. This helps give the character a little bit more outline, okay? So that's what's very important. It also helps you see a little bit of that subsurface scattering come out. So that's looking really nice. I'm quite happy with that. So Marmoset Toolbag, very, very useful little tool for you to utilize. Definitely worth getting, because the final result, especially if you don't really care, you don't want full blown ray tracing accuracy, is actually really good. So the end result is still quite nice. Now let me just go ahead and play around with some of the ambient occlusion, because there is an issue here with the ambient occlusion and that's not jiving with me. So I'm just going to try and see if I can play around with that a little bit. Now when it comes to the eyes as well, I'm going to also add an emissive, just an emissive map, which is going to be the eye, because I want the eye to still stand out. Just going to add a little bit of extra occlusion. Play around with the size. Okay, so that's looking quite nice. Playing with the skin a little bit, see if I can get a better result. So I'm just going to play around with the shadow blur and the occlusion, so I think that's pretty good. Okay, I'm looking at this character right now, very, very happy with her pose, everything is quite nice. We can actually do a turnaround and we'll still get a good result. Okay, but I'm not after the turnaround, I just want the rendered characters somewhat like this. I'm going to adjust this particular point light now, so because there's just too much lighting on the front end of her, so I just want to add give her a little bit more contrast by giving her lack of light, so something like that. Okay, this gives the character a little bit more color contrast, so you got more dark areas that help the character sort of stand out. Just makes it a little nicer to work with. There we go. And we're just adjusting the eyes. Of course, I'm also going to have to add some color to the lighting of the eyes, just to try and match the surrounding lighting. Oh, one other thing I forgot was the brows. I forgot to add the brow color and the eyelashes as well, so do not want to forget that. There we go. So she does have a much nicer looking pose. Now when it comes to the eyelashes here, I can't actually see the rest of the eyelash, so I'm going to have to change that manually. That's not an issue, generally speaking. You can make it black as well. I might actually just leave it black, because eyelashes tend to be quite dark. It helps accentuate the eye itself. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to leave that there. Oops, I've got the face here. Okay, when the fuzz has come, we're going to so fuzz occlusion, we're just going to add that. I'm going to increase the fuzz so that I can see the fuzz. Okay, that's looking good, except the lighting, it's still giving me some weird shadows, which is not what I want. I want to avoid those shadows. And that's, again, it's primarily a rigging issue. You have to adjust it later on, but for now, this is quite nice. Okay, so that's good. I'm going to leave that here. Let's go ahead and save this out. I'm going to call this Nardeen Dance. Just save it on the ZBrush. And if you want any other adjustments, feel free to make them. Maybe play around with the lighting, see if it comes, if it gives you some nice results, for example. Maybe I can play around the lighting here. I don't think I want to though, because I'm quite happy with how it's turning out. So we can play with the lighting if we want. No, I kind of want some of her face to show. So I'll probably just stick with backlighting. Something like that. Okay, so that's looking nice. Let's see what else we can do. I kind of want that strong lighting on this side as well. All right, looking fantastic. Another thing is, I probably want to change the lighting to maybe white. No, I think I'll leave it as, probably just bring it to a more reddish color. Just a warmer color, okay? So she's sort of indoors dancing for someone, I don't know. I'm just testing to see if there's any other lighting angles that we can get this looking right. Now, typically if you're doing this in, for example, Maya or Mental Ray or V-Ray, it would take you a long time, like a ridiculous amount of time to get right. Because you actually have to pose, relight, move the lights, and then render out the character, render it out just to see how the light is affecting the character. So that takes a long time, and that's not what I'm going to do. So that's why Marmoset is so good for relatively quick results. Okay, so that's what we're doing. Okay, I might just add a slight angle here to her ears. Okay, so that's nice. It's got a nice softness to it, and the pose is readable. It's looking fantastic. So it's all a matter of really just going to your capture here. We're going to go to settings, and I'm going to make the height about 4K, so 4,000, width maybe 6,000, because really it's not that much. We also want to add transparency. I'm going to leave the sampling at 16. And I'm just looking at this right now, just trying to find the perfect angle for this character, so something like that. Or maybe like this. I'm not sure. We can also do a turntable, but I'm not going to do that for now. I think I'm happy with that. So what we do is we just go to F11 or capture image, and this will basically render this out. Now, where it's going to render it out, I have no idea. I need to find it, so hopefully it's just going to be on my desktop. And we just play the waiting game. So far, that's the general gist of how you create your character from start to finish. You've kind of seen this in the episodes you've seen in my channel. What we need to do now, just to finalize this, is we're going to actually create the background. And the background is actually quite simple. You can create your own background if you want. So I'm just going to drag that screenshot into After Effects. I'm actually to create Nardeen demo folder. Okay, so this is the screenshot, and let's apply this in a scene. So that's the full render of my character. Okay, now this is where you want to go in and just double check to make sure there are no blemishes, like in terms of modeling. If the model is looking bad or if there's some clipping, if it's a small issue, then you can sort of touch it up. But if it's a big issue, like serious clipping, then you probably want to fix up your character and re-render. So it's actually quite fast, but this is quite pristine as far as I can see in terms of presentation, and kind of we're at the point where we can actually apply the background. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm just going to mask that out. So that's our character, and creating background is actually quite simple. I'm just going to use a very simple grunge texture. Pardon me. And if I can find this inside my little library here. By the way, this is something I created myself. So these are all of my textures ready to go. So I've got a grunge texture that I'm going to bring in here. Let's go ahead and highlight this as yellow, as the top one. And we're going to work with the background first. And I'm going to go curves, create a curve. And let's make this super, super dense, or really, really crushed. Okay. So we get some like nice results. Alright, I'm going to apply a hue saturation. Let's go ahead and turn it off completely. Okay, which is nice. You can go ahead and create another curve. I'm going to do that. I'm just going to apply this underneath the hue saturation because I do want to bring that color up. Okay, and we'll just adjust that. Alright, let's go ahead and create a solid color. Let's put it underneath the character. I'm going to apply an overlay. Whoops, sorry, overlay on the solid color. Okay, because we're actually getting the background. I also need to create a black background right here. And for the solid color, let's change the color to something like a pinkish sort of a hue. Now, you've already seen my original here, so I'm basically going to duplicate this as best as I can. It's not going to be exact, of course, but if we just presenting this to the world, so I want it a warm, kind of a warm pink as best as we can, because it just fits the character really. There's no other way of going about it. Alright, so now we've got our solid color. I'm going to apply a feather, and we can just drag and drop it in here like that. Now some of it is a bit too hot, so I'm duplicating it, by the way. What I'm going to do is I'm going to duplicate to the other side. I'm going to apply a blue hue. So let's change the color of our solid. Let's apply blue hue. Oops, I should have turned it to affect only selected layers. So that's what I'm going to do. There we go. So blue hue. Same down below over here. Okay, that's looking good. Now, in terms of the grunge map, I'm going to create, just duplicate it, shrink it slightly, maybe rotate it a little bit until we get something that looks a little bit like that. And don't worry too much because we are going to adjust this inside of Photoshop as a final touch-up. I'm also going to create an orange color here. So just an orange. Because, by the way, she does have a little bit of that as well. And it sort of adds a little bit more pizzazz, in my opinion. Of course, your opinion, your style is going to be slightly different. You can't really stick with one person's artistic eye. You will have your own, and that's what's important, okay? Find something that works and looks good for you, and then we can go from there. Okay, I'm just going to give a little bit more height, so 5. You can see we can, and we are going over time limit, so this is about an hour 16 in, so we're just going to finish this off as fast as we can, or as best as we can actually. So we do want good results at the end of the day, so try not to rush. Okay, so that's looking nice. With the character itself, we're going to grab a curve, and I do want to adjust the brightness of her. She is a little bit dark, and that's because we were adding some contrast. Don't worry too much because we are going to adjust her a little bit inside of Photoshop. So what we're doing is we're trying to get just bring up some of the warmth, and then maybe apply a little bit of cool colors at the end of the day. So let's see what we get. So that's pretty good for her color scheme. Alright, happy with that. Let's go ahead and create the bottom part, which is what she's going to be standing on. So I'm going to create the grunge. And we're going to rotate the bottom floor 90 degrees. And I'm just going to move it down roughly around her feet, like this. And using the same trick we did before. What we're going to do is going to apply the control curves. I might actually just copy and paste these curves here. Okay, so something like that. That's kind of the floor she's standing on already. I don't really have to worry about anything else. If you want, you can go ahead and create like a basic mask on the bottom. So let's go ahead and do that. I might actually adjust some of it because I don't want it to be too too far out. And of course we want to mask it, give it a mask feather so we have a nice soft edge on the bottom. And same deal with the top. I'm just going to take a look and see what I've got down here. So I've kind of followed a very similar fashion. That's kind of what I'm going to do. Let's go ahead and grab the orange colors. I'm just going to put it on top like that. Okay, same with the blue. So you can see the theme here is quite focused on the primary colors, so red, yellow, blue. Not too sure how that, in terms of the repercussions of this character, but it might give, might just give us a bit of a insight on what the character is like, actually, so it could be really, really good. But we're just creating a very basic background, we're not trying to be totally perfect with that, so I'm just turning that yellow, and I feel that there's just a little bit too much color, so what I want to do is maybe, I might just turn this off and see what we get. I actually do want the hot pink, so. And we'll maybe just tune that down slightly, and there's a reason for this, because we're going to create something a little bit different inside, well, do some adjustments inside of Photoshop. So that's pretty good. One other thing is I need to create some basic ambient occlusion underneath her, so once again, very, very simple. We're just going to create a black background like this. And then we'll hopefully get a good result. Okay, so that's looking good. And so far, we've gotten to the point of rendering, which is quite good. And I think I'm quite happy with how this is turning out. So let's go ahead and render this out. Very, very simple. First, I want to save my project. So for this Nardeen demo. That's a complete character right there. And what I'm going to do is go ahead and save the frame, because remember this is just a simple frame, so we'll just call it Nardeen, have it as at best settings, and once we're ready we'll go ahead and render this out, which I believe is done. So let's bring this into Photoshop now. I'm just going to close this down. And we will... Actually, I don't believe that was complete. Let me try that again. So I'm just going to save this out, but we'll save the frame. I might have to create a new template, so I'm going to use a PNG because that's kind of the best way to go. So quality is best. Oops, or actually custom template. So call PNG. It's kind of strange, the settings are a bit off, so. Okay, we'll leave it as it is. Save it as best as, and actually, it actually did come in, my apologies. All right, so now we're going to do some touching up. And because it is a flat layer, this is going to be a little bit tricky, especially when you try to do very, very tiny touch-ups. And the touch-ups is mainly just to make sure the character looks good as a still frame. And what I'm going to do is hopefully be able to get some decent results. So I'm going to use a feather brush here. And we're going to start just by masking some of those edges on our canvas here. Okay, so make sure the edges are nice and soft. Okay, because we do want to keep it within the boundaries. If the boundaries are a bit too high, it makes it a bit hard for the character to work. So that's looking good. All right, I'm going to create a new layer. Let's go ahead and use an overlay, and we're just going to add a little bit of extra color, not that we need it too much. So we're going to go ahead and do that. So I'm going to start with like an orange color or yellow color, and this just helps bring the character's appearance out. We're just trying to increase some of that brightness. Okay, so using a very, very soft brush, I'm also going to change it to a blue, just applying some extra splash of color here. Okay, just a bit of extra brightness so that we can see the character itself. Okay, down here what I want to do is add a very hard blue to give some cool colors or exaggerate some of that ambient occlusion. Just on the skirt here, it just gives her a little bit more color. Might use the red over here. Again, we're just exaggerating some of those features. All right. Of course, down here, I'm going to soften that ambient occlusion, and up here, maybe give her a little bit more warmth on her face. So hopefully that's not going to be too overpowering, but we can also adjust this later as well. So that, don't worry too much about that. So that warmth on the face will work nicely. Might also use a white color just to exaggerate her hands and some parts of her clothing as well. And finally, I think I also need to fix up her feet here, so let's go ahead and do that, and then we should be done. So let's go ahead and mask her feet out. I might have to, it's kind of annoying that I have to do this manually, so I'm just going to do that. Probably should have been done inside of After Effects, but that's okay. Normally if you're rendering this out in, say for example, Mental Ray or Maya, there's going to be some features like ambient occlusion. You can create your own ambient occlusion pass, and then you can get some, well, we'll try and get some good results. So we're just trying to see if we can get the feet a little bit darker. I'm not worried about the holes down there either, so let's just forget them. And we're just going to focus only on the feet. So mask around the feet, just make it darker, and we're pretty much done. So what I'm going to do is copy, paste that in, and then use the curve just to make it a bit darker, like that. And that's basically it. So far, looking really nice. I'm quite happy with that. I'm going to create another overlay. This time I want to exaggerate the bottom of that. Okay, there's just not enough brightness, and it's probably my fault because I do want the bottom to be a little bit brighter. But we can do that by adding a little splash of color like this. Okay, so that's looking good. And finally, we'll just put an adjustment layer on top of everything. So we'll just go ahead and create curves. We'll just play around with the control curves, and that'll basically be it. So the curve that I'm using is the typical S curve, okay? Don't want it too harsh, so just very basic curve to bring out a little bit more contrast and hopefully get a good result. Alrighty, so that's basically it. And what I'm going to do is just save this out as a complete, just the final JPEG. So we'll use final. And from here, you can go ahead and reduce the size and create thumbnails for your